So, to fix it. Okay. Okay, I know we're a little bit over, so let's get started. Okay, my name is Dimitri Kuhr, I work at Bloomberg. Email is over there, it's all lovely. Bloomberg is a great place to work at, but this is not the work I do over here. This is only mildly related to things we do at Bloomberg. It's basically, we have something similar to that. What I'm presenting is primarily driven from me wanting to propose something for the standard, how to do hashing, but the proposal is partly written but not done. Okay, so what I want to talk about is, first off, I want to talk why I'm interested in hashing to start with. Then I want to talk and hashing in the sense of turning a value into a hash code, nothing on hashtags or any of that. Then I want to talk a little bit about hash functions to actually produce a hash, and primarily why not to do it yourself. The main part is very short, is actually how to turn create hash values for user-defined types. And then I want to talk a little bit about variation of hashing containers outside the space of the standard. So the main reason an important operations I need to do a lot is basically looking up a value based on a key. Relatively simple. We know how to do that. We could do it like that. It's basically find if, yes, we search for that, and people advise that this may actually be the fastest method if you have very few values. And it's a linear approach, it's fine. We could do something like that. That's a little bit bare bones, a little bit more complicated. Now we have a sorted sequence, we use lower bound. We also need to check that we actually found a value over there, which is a little bit awkward, so people typically don't use lower bound directly, use something different, and typically not in a flat hierarchy, but to use something like a map, which is basically still same idea of the algorithm. It's typically binary search, find things. Over here, we get the same interface as for the find if. If you haven't found it, we get the end back. There's an implication before, so far we, for lower bound and this one, we need to have a less than operator. For the find if, we only needed an equality operator. Both of these operators are actually relatively easy to write. Most people know how to do that. And then there's this fella over here. We use an unordered map. Has the same interface as the previous one, like this one. It looks really, you can nearly replace it. However, there's an implication which is new, and that is that there's a hash of the key defined in some shape or form. For many keys, like strings, by default is defined, or for integers, it's defined. For user-defined types, not so much. And that's the problem. So for a long time, I was going and saying, well, I don't care about hashing, I just use maps. And some people said, well, but hash maps are way faster. Eventually, I went and measured. So here are some measurements. This funny line over here, which would go very high and make everything invisible, this is fine, so don't use that. Interestingly, this starts to be slower than any of the other approaches already at 10 elements. This is on this particular computer using this particular compiler and this particular standard library, but the picture will be relatively the same. So you don't want to use a linear search. The other curves are a little bit more interesting. These two curves is basically, what was the variation of, one of is lower bound, I don't know which one, and the other one is basically, I use sets over here to erase a little bit of the lookup stuff, or the cache alignment stuff. So it's basically sets, so this one is lower bound on a set, the other one is lower bound on an ordered range. And all the guys which look a little bit nicer are down here, which are all variations of hash sets. That's basically, and the axis, by the way, is time. So the longer it takes is bad. You want to go as close to the bottom as possible. I think the blue one is a boost hash, boost unordered map. The red one is a stood unordered map. And the green one is an, I think, interesting idea, which I present a vague idea of how that works. It's basically a different hash set has different promises, but you can actually get faster than the standard library reasonably easily. So, and especially this thing being curved up while this thing actually stays flat is the reason why I want to do these things. It would be nice if they were really flat. They seem to be a little bit sloping upwards, which I haven't entirely tracked down, but I suspect this is basically accessing different levels of memory. So you basically eventually, in the beginning, you're all in cache, eventually you hit further out cache, and that probably makes them slope up. In any case, it should be flat in theory. So there are a few caveats, and the biggest caveat is, and some of these caveats are not necessarily as obvious as it is. The performance of the hash sets, people always assume it is all of one. That is not entirely true. It is expected all of one. The difference between it is all of one and expected all of one is it may actually be linear. And that is if you have a bad hash or you go unlucky or somebody is evil and everything actually gets the same hash key, then you turn something you expect to be really fast into something which is actually fairly slow. You can counter that to a little extent. Normally the conflict resolution, if you have two keys which map to the same hash code, you normally have a linear list or some linear searching mechanism. You could in theory in each cell have a binary tree in there, so your worst case behavior would not be linear but logarithmic. You can bring it down to that. I'm not aware of anybody actually doing that in practice, but it could be linear. So, and that is a real threat. The real threat over there is if you actually have somebody who's evil to you and actually knows that you use a specific hash and can feed keys in, which are likely to cache into the same thing, is basically a really, really nice way to do a denial of service attack. It just keeps busy searching through the same silly list over and over again. And that is apparently a real thing. At least Google has some instances where they reported that people try to do that, which basically says there's an arms race between people creating hashes and others. In that sense, it's actually relatively important to create hashes such that it's less likely that you're exposed. Okay, so the other thing is on that is the expected all of one often means that you create a stronger hash, which typically takes longer. Whether that is true or not depends a little bit on the hashing algorithm, but on average, the stronger your hash is, the less likely you run into the linear case or the bad cases, but it's often a little bit slower to compute. So it's basically a trade-off between the strength of your hash and the algorithm and the chance of conflicts. Speed. So, So hash is basically the idea of a denial of target attack on the basis of that. We basically, if they're known how to create conflicts, and there are many ways how we can know that you can create a conflict. For example, if part of the key is not hashed, say somebody knows that strings may be long and goes, well, we don't really care. It's normally okay if I hash the first 16 characters, and then somebody just comes along and starts adding characters in the back, and the first 16 characters are all the same, then you start getting a problem relatively soon. This is one example, or if you have a known hashing algorithm, they may be actually more constructive to actually feed just the right strings in to make sure each string is different, but they are all hashing to the same value. So there are a number of countermeasures. Some of them are relatively straightforward. You could, for example, go and at the beginning of a run, toss a coin and say, I use this hashing algorithm, so you know, make it harder for anybody trying to game your system to say, all right, I need to cover lots of hashing algorithms. You can spend more time on creating a hashing algorithm. And another one is to actually kind of seed the hash differently. Often they're based on the existing value in the hash. If you add more things, it's often unpredictable, or the hashes are constructed, algorithms are constructed such that it's fairly unpredictable given us from different states. If you add different characters, it should yield entirely different values. So that is kind of the game this is about. There's an idea over here because, as I said, the stronger your hash is, the more time it probably costs. Which gives the idea of you may actually have different hashing approaches entirely depending on where you use your hash. For example, there are ideas, or some people use basically a hash algorithm to index into databases. So in the database, if your index is based on a hash, that is fairly stable. You probably do not change that a lot. Maybe you cannot even change it at all. So the idea would be over there, you probably want to use a stronger algorithm, which is a little bit slower in return of making it hard to attack. And you may actually also use a longer key. If you look at something like the MD5 stuff or things, this is basically a hash key, but it's often not just 64-bit or something like that. It's, I don't know how long they're, 1K-bit or something like that. So they're way, way bigger. You can do something like that if you store hashes as well, to actually, instead of storing one word, store multiple words. Within a process, you probably want to not use a super strong thing because it's kind of a trade-off between time and risk. And so, but it may be very reasonable to basically use a fairly strong algorithm and change it at least on every run. And then if you have short-lived containers, it may actually be reasonable to actually use a relatively weak but fast hash in return every cycle of the hash seed, for example, every time so an attacker has very hard time to predict what are the right values for the hash currently in use. So there may be a scope to actually use different hashing algorithms. With respect to hashing algorithms, is designing one yourself. This is what I've done in the past. Yes, I need to hash the thing, so I shifted a little bit over here and XORed a little bit over there. All of these hashes, who has done that? Who has ever written a hash which does a little bit shifting here, right? Don't. This is bad. All of these are bad. Obviously, if you know what you're doing, you can design a hash algorithm. I'm not trying to entice you, just saying I would nowadays just go take one from somewhere and stick it in and use it. Which, however, also means ideally these hash algorithms are captured in a library and you should not bother implementing them because even if you copy them from the web, you may make silly mistakes because the details on the web are not always entirely in sync and sometimes the size of a word actually does matter and you may have accidentally used an integer of long instead of long because that's what the code said, but it was 64-bit. Where the author wrote and you get 32 bits or things like that. So ideally it should be in a library. And that is the basis of why I embarked on hashing to start with, to basically put that in a standard library so you could just use something from there. Okay, nonetheless, I want to show a little bit of the considerations and then also a little bit of the algorithms which are actually being used so to get an idea that they're actually really not just a little bit of shifting or more constructive in there. So the considerations is often, obviously, a hash should be fast. You can probably compute really strong things if you can spend a lot of time, but that defeats the entire purpose of the hash. You basically, sure, it would be more constant time and not logarithmic, but realistically, systems are bounded, so eventually, if you spend enough time, the logarithmic stuff doesn't matter anymore either. When actually computing them to make sure that they don't collide, you pretty much want to make sure that the values are uniformly distributed, whatever that means. So the idea is basically to make sure that all the bits change in the same way. So you should be able to use any bits in your hash, in the produced hash, for a hashing into a hash container. It's not a good idea to say, all right, oh yeah, produce a hash in a 64-bit variable which actually uses only 40 bits of that or something like that. And then the other aspect of the uniform distribution in principle, which should mean whenever you flip one of the bits in your entire input, what you have, roughly half the bits in your hash value should change. So basically, any bit change, any bit contributed, should make a difference. And just basically to avoid making it predictable and all of that. So the general layout of all the hashing algorithms roughly consists of, there's a little bit of initialization, which may be sometimes trivial. There's typically a bit of combination, which is actually the heart of the algorithm, which is typically very non-trivial, or this is where the actual work happens. And then there's also a reduction step. The interesting bit in the initialization and the reduction step is some people have the idea of, oh, I know how to combine a hash. If I have something which is hashable, like let's say an integer and a string, then I hash the integer and then I hash the string, and then I take these two things and hash the two hash values to get a hash value of a combination of that. That's probably a bad idea, especially if you have an algorithm where the initialization or the reduction takes has some effort. And some of the better algorithms actually have exactly that. And it's also a bad idea because you can show mathematically that reducing to hash value basically increases the rates. If you combine already hashed values, rather than combining the whole thing, you increase the chances of conflicts. The proof for that I don't recall, but was relatively, it wasn't super complicated. But that is a thing. So combining hashes is not a good idea. You probably want to combine all the bits into a hash. And so, but I get to that. So I want to first show a couple of algorithms, how they look like. For example, there's a fairly popular one, the Jenkins algorithm. Jenkins, it's called. The initialization, really straightforward, doesn't do much work. The actual combination is basically operating on addition being somewhat unpredictable because the bits actually change due to the overflow in an interesting way. And it basically doesn't always just add something. It shifts a little bit, and it shifts in the opposite direction and uses XOR to basically make sure the bits actually get distributed nicely over the entire range. You may need to some actually over here a few minimal size before you hit the higher bits. And so this is a base algorithm, and towards the end it basically metals up the bits again. The last step is primarily used to make sure that you actually, even if you have only contributed two characters or something like that, that some of the high-level characters, high-level bits actually are also set. So this is one guy. It's actually relatively strong. It's reasonably fast. And my understanding is some people have ideas how to game that. One way to actually make it a little bit harder to game is instead of initializing with zero all the time, you could basically go and say, we initialize it with a seed, or basically add a number of characters as a seed, one of these two. It's roughly the same. This is a similar idea for seeding for all the algorithms. Another one, which is actually fairly popular, FNV1, actually has a nicely simple initialization and a nice simple reduction. It looks simpler, and the slightly costly bit over here is the multiplication. But the multiplication uses a prime, but not any prime. This prime is actually how exactly it is chosen. I'm a little bit unclear, but the basic idea is whenever you add something or multiply with that, it kind of distributes the bits reasonably evenly. And multiplication is relatively hard to predict where the bits actually go. And it's entirely operating on an unsigned, so it can happily overflow because it keeps overflowing all the time. And bit is actually added over here. Some people complain that actually this algorithm is kind of silly. It does a multiplication before it does anything at all. It could actually just reverse these two things. And that actually does work. This algorithm is then called FNVA, FNV1A. It's basically kind of the same algorithm, just doing slightly different things. But this is basically using the multiplication to make it unpredictable. Another one, which is, I think, a cute idea, is I lift some of the implementation of that out. This is the dot, dot, dots over there. It's basically, it uses an array of 256 values, which are basically randomly shuffled. And then in the body of the algorithm, it goes, it produces one byte at a time. And the byte is produced by basically looking up in the table the current byte, which we produce XORed with the current character, that gives us the next byte. So you basically jump around in that table like no good. There's a lot of memory accesses, which is maybe not ideal, and we run through the table multiple times. So this outer loop actually runs through the table four times because we produce a 32-bit value. Obviously, C++ being C++, we could actually nicely unroll the loop and do that even fairly compact. This is the same algorithm as before, just unrolled, taking advantage of the pack expansion. And admittedly, this is basically an intermediate step so that I get actually the indices. And this actually makes the algorithm indeed faster by basically if you have longer strings if you rock over the array at the same time, producing all the bytes at once, it actually speeds things up. And the compiler doesn't see through that, so it doesn't go and say, all right, I know I can unroll this thing. It's too complicated for the compiler. So this guy also produces actually fairly good hashes. And it's the main issue over here is coming up with a nice table and holding onto the table somewhere. Over here, just put it into a static function local static variable, but it would need to live somewhere. And then people observed that all the other ones operate always on char, this kind of all bytes. This is kind of annoying. Why not actually utilize the entire word? And that looks relatively expensive. We have actually two multiplications over here. But the key advantage is it doesn't operate on characters, but we basically take four bytes in this case and combine all the four at once. This is a MIRMA hash, and basically it again has a base computation and then some messing up towards the end, which is relatively expensive. So if you, for example, hash each of your values individually with these guys, it does relatively little work in each iteration, but does quite a bit of work in the recombination of stuff. And you would do that actually three times instead of once by when you added the bytes. So this is just some of the ideas. There are other things where they basically try to do similarly cheap operations a lot of times quickly, and people are actually adamant that the compiler is capable sometimes to vectorize these things and that there's a fast pass. So all this stuff should be implemented inlineable and all of that. So getting in any case, coming up with an algorithm like that and with all the correct values, like these values chosen over there, are kind of deliberately chosen. They're then experimented against a test suite, which basically verifies that the algorithm actually has the necessary properties we want it to have, and all that is actually relatively complicated and fragile. So you don't really, or I wouldn't want to do that if I need to come up with a hash. Okay, however, I do have the desire to have hashes for user-defined types. And there are a few properties which we obviously want over there. The first one is obvious, otherwise hashing doesn't work. If I have an A and a B which are equal, whatever the equality of that type means, this is kind of type-specific, so it's not necessarily all the bits. But if A and B are equal, it means that the hash of A and the hash of B have to be equal as well. Otherwise, hash maps don't work. That's obvious. However, it's not entirely trivial to get that right. And there are some examples down there to do. The other direction we would like to have as well, like if you have the hash of A and the hash of B, we actually want to have A and B, if they're equal, we actually would like A and B to be equal as well. So we want that with high probability, which basically just says there should be very few collisions. So one obvious idea could be, all right, we just take all the bytes of the algorithm, of the representation, and we just stick them in. Often that doesn't work because the representation may contain a pointer. Like just hashing a string doesn't work. You need to not just hash the string, you need to hash the characters of the string. And I will later explain that you also need to hash the size, actually. So there's one problem. The other problem is some values actually are equal, like -0 and 0 are equal. In fact, mathematically, -0 doesn't make any sense. However, the representation of -0 and 0 is actually different in IEEE. So if you just hash floating point numbers, you will have problems. So this is where you very easily have a conflict. And then if you hash some words, there are padding bytes in there. Just to display that a little bit, here's a type. They're basically stuck in a pointer. Okay, it's a unique pointer, but it doesn't really matter much. A float, a short, and a char. And if you look at the layout, well, unsurprisingly, the pointers actually utterly unhelpful because A, they are different, although the pointer to value is the same. So this doesn't make any sense. The -0 and 0, actually, this is the red part over here, and there's basically a nice 8 and a versus a 0, so the high bit of the value is actually set. Okay, the short and the char, they are fine. And interestingly, when I actually tested it, by basically populating it pretty much like it's done over here. There's always a zero in there, even if I've made sure that the memory where I store the thing didn't contain zeros. So in this case, the compiler actually stored things. Somebody made the observation that the compiler probably sees through part of these things and goes, well, I know how the byte sequence of all these things looks like, and I just memcopy the byte sequence, so I don't care that, because I actually use constants. So the theory is that that may go away when they're constants. But there's padding in there. This is basically just printing the bytes for the size of that thing, and there's some padding which may be a problem. Okay, so we don't want that. The basic idea of what we want to do is effectively we want to feed all the salient attributes of a type into a hash algorithm. And there's basically two dimensions over there. One dimension I've called over here hash code. This is the idea we have an algorithm which knows how to compute these things. And the other dimension of variability is you have your user-defined types which you need to decompose in some form. And this is this uses hash expansion over here. So the basic idea is the hash code gets all the bytes exposed and combines them, hopefully using inline functions. The hash code itself actually uses static members for various reasons. And all of these could be inlined. And then basically the idea is that few library implementers would implement an implementation of hash code. So that can be reasonably complicated and whatever goes in there, because it's hopefully done by experts. And then hash expansion should be reasonably simple, because every user who wants to expose something would use hash code, but actually write a hash expansion for their user-defined type. So that needs to be reasonably simple, but still observing performance constraints. The entire idea of that split, by the way, is not mine. This is basically what I present over here. Uses slightly different names, but it's basically what Google does in AppSci. This is based on so Google had proposed hashing that kind of dropped the ball, enhanced their approach a little bit further in AppSci, and the hope is that we basically build a proposal for the standard to do that actually in the standard library out of all of that. Okay, so the basic idea of hash expansion is fairly simple. We basically just recursively decompose our objects. So the basic idea is we get an algorithm in. The interesting aspect over here, the algorithm actually is passed by value, but this is also where we capture all the bits. And we get some value in, and let's say this guy has two salient members. We would basically combine the first member and the second member. And this guy normally should only be movable, should not be copy constructible. The entire dance we do over here is the compiler guys are adamant that it's good if we travel in terms of concrete types rather than references, because that makes inlining and all kind of analyzers easier. And on the other hand, we may have a reasonable or a bigger state of some of the hash coding. We basically do not just encode an integer. You may actually encode maybe into an array of bits which is eventually combined. So there's a desire to say we actually want to not copy that, the internal state, but we actually just want to move it. That's the reason why the entire thing comes in by value, so we can optimize, and then we need to move this guy into a value, and then append more, and append another value. So this is the basic setup. This guy actually uses the hash code, which is basically a default algorithm, and it's just moving over here. Okay, so the move is important. We could actually, and the proposal would basically also go and say, if you actually just have something as simple as that, where you actually know all your values ahead, you could just put them into one line, so you basically don't need to do any moving, you can just return it. However, if you have a more complicated structure and you may need to walk a tree or something like that, then you would do something along those lines to walk all the elements. Okay, so this one direction. The other direction, this hash code is basically, this is a concrete type. and is something reasonable to use if you actually have, let's say, polymorphic functions. In a lot of cases, you would like to say, I don't really want to encode something like that. I want to really get inlining out of that. And in this case, you would actually implement your hash expansion not as a concrete function, but as a function template. The idea over here is the template passes in the algorithm. The algorithm is actually never really touched or never stored or something like that. So there's no vocabulary problem by basically saying you have multiple of these guys and you need to somehow interact with them. It's all fine. And you still do the same thing. So these guys would all have to expose the corresponding combine methods. And the entire idea of having the hash combine stuff being static members, which can't be inline on a function, is if you implement something like hash code, you could actually just implement one function and inherit from a base class where you inherit all the fancy other things, and you do basically CRTP, the curiously concurrent template pattern, where you basically pass in your actual type for the actual hashing. This way the compiler can see and inline all of these things, and you can still customize all the versions of your functions which are present and you want to customize, but you can have still default functions without any virtual functions being called at any point in time. So this is the idea. So, and then now, how is hash expansion actually implemented? And there are a few things which are interesting to realize, and I certainly, while reading all the standards papers, I learned some of those. The obvious one is, if you want to hash a struct, you just hash all the members. That is relatively straightforward and simple. It becomes a little bit more interesting if you hash a union or a variant. It doesn't really matter whether it's a union or variant. Now, they can have different types, and different types probably are different in some shape or form, depending on what they are. And basically, to avoid having a potential conflict between the union member being one set of bits when looked at as an integer, and the same set of bits when looked at as a string, for example, or whatever is in there, you actually want to not just only hash the actual union member, but you also want to hash kind of a descriptor which says this type is in there. And there's basically an advantage to put that last. So you basically, when hashing a union or a variant, you basically hash the actual value followed by a descriptor of what is actually inside. In a similar way, you would do that with optionals. You basically hash an optional followed by a flag whether data is present. The reason over there is a little bit different. The reason is, if you imagine you have a vector of optionals and some of these things are not set, or the majority is maybe not set. Let's say we have a vector of 10 elements and only one of them is set at all time. Depending on which one is set, you would actually produce the same hash if you do not have an indicator which one is hashed. So you basically need to, every time you do something, you kind of need to add a bit of information saying, right, advance to the next kind of state so that you actually get different bits. This is the reasoning for the optional, that you want to not just hash the data, but also the key. And then in a very similar sense, just a little bit more complicated, if you append a sequence, it's not enough to just append the sequence, but you also need to append the size. So you append the sequence values followed by the size. It's the same reasoning. If you do not append the size, you could have a vector of strings, let's say, and in the first one you have the first string is AB followed by a C, and the next string you have A followed by BC. You want to distinguish between these two values. They should not hash to the same thing. So that is actually kind of a little bit magic, but this is relatively important. And I certainly didn't come up with that realization myself. I needed to be told. Yes?
So it occurs to me that there's one special value that could happen, which is an unset optional. If you have a whole bunch of unset optionals, regardless of, they might be the same type, they might be different types. If they're different types, hashing on the type could conceivably help. Do optionals that are unset compare equal? Two optionals of the same type that are unset compare equal?
Two optionals of the same type, which are not set, should I think they compare equal.
I think they do too. And I think
everything else would be insane. Now, options of different types. You basically, now, if you have a sequence of optional of different types, you don't really have that. We normally call that variant or as a pointer to some things. So over there, you get, but in case where you have a sequence of values with a different type, you probably want to have this kind of the union case. You want to have a type indicator, a descriptor of what is in there, in addition to the bits, because the bits may be the same between different types.
So the only case I could imagine where that would happen would be an unset variant, because, I mean, if you, what
right.
are the chances, I mean, except for unset, what are the chances that a double and an int would have the same value?
Not high. But they certainly do exist. I mean, all 32-bit values of int and value are, have a value, and not all of them are entirely insane.
But is it worthwhile to have the extra cost? You see what I'm saying, right?
I see what you're saying. Is it worthwhile to have the extra cost of adding a little bit of information? Well, if you do not do that, you basically give somebody who wants to game your system the direct advantage that he can go, all right, yeah. I just put these things in.
If you have something that's client-facing, you really have to worry about security.
Yes.
If you have something that's internal that's not client-facing, then it becomes every operation is a cost.
Right, sure. If something internal, you can say, well, over there we don't really have that security concern because we are not actively bad to each other. However, we may be accidentally bad to each other. Mm-hmm. Or actually you may have somebody who's about to get fired. Right. Either way, we still don't want to do that. It still kind of poses, in my opinion, a security risk. And actually, adding a little bit of information every time is not such a huge cost. Okay. Right. If you actually have if you're concerned about adding one extra indicator for your 100 million elements, well, your 100 million elements probably take a long time already. Mm. Right. Okay. It takes a little bit more, but actually the memory access to all the stuff to figure that out is probably the more expensive stuff to start with, rather than the extra hashing operation. Okay? Not convinced, but okay. We can hash that out later, maybe. Okay, so far I talked a little bit about how do we build hashes. So there's another interesting question potentially. Let's say you actually want to use them. At the moment, the way you can use a hash container is you could basically customize std hash for and then use unordered map directly. Because the way unordered map with a key is, by default, it uses std hash with that key. Now, that is not necessarily entirely satisfactory, because if you have actually multiple algorithms, you have a hard time choosing them. So you can actually pass in a hashing algorithm as a special argument, which would at least say, right, we can actually change these things. There's a caveat to doing so, unfortunately, and that is if you actually do something like that, the implication is that your unordered maps are actually different types, obviously, right, because this is a template parameter. So if you do that internally in your class and you use one of these guys and you do not pass it anywhere, then that is fine. However, an unordered map with a custom hash function in an interface is probably a bad thing, because it basically means you would either need to templatize everything or you need to agree in a huge system on the same things, so that doesn't necessarily work. And then, because as mentioned earlier, we want to seed these things, if you actually, independent on whether I use the default or not, you can actually pass in an argument which for the hashing algorithm into the constructor of unordered map to take that on. So it basically takes, by default, it defaults constructs the state, but if you actually have an hash full hash state, you probably, or you could pass that as an argument. Now, one way which I have not experimented with is, well, to some extent, this kind of guy is actually similar to an allocator, right? You could go, let's say, the hash thing over there is actually always stateful and has an internally an hashing algorithm, and actually there's a virtual dispatch at some point. That may or may not be worthwhile, especially if you have these guys in interfaces. Okay, so this is how we could actually use them. Now, one of the other things is if something like this hash expansion thingy actually becomes a proposal, nobody would want to write the hash stuff to just forward to the hash expansion thing. So that this thing should actually ideally plug directly into the std hash, into the default hashing algorithm, so that basically instead of having to customize std hash, explicitly specialize std hash for your type, the default implementation would basically just go and say, is there a hash combine and can I do it? If so, then I call that. If not, I still have an error. Nowadays, this is actually relatively simple to figure out with some of the mechanics we have. And then there's another interesting aspect, and that is if we have a hashing algorithm and we put that into a container, we should actually make sure that it always changes on every run. The reason for that is if we actually decide to say, well, between runs, the hash is actually the same, and we may change it once in a while. There's something awful which developers keep doing, and that is they depend on these details. A simple example of where it would depend on that is, let's say, you put things into a hash and you into some class, and you want to test whether all the elements are in there. Well, an easy way to do that is you iterate over them, and you compare that against the list of expected things, and you do one-to-one comparison. Right, we have basically tested against the golden copy. Now, some guy figures out that, oh, the hash is actually an attack. Somebody figured out how to game this thing and wants to change it. He breaks your test by changing the base library. On the other hand, if the algorithm actually changes or the seed changes between different runs, your test always fails if you do something like that. You need to work harder to make your test work. As a result, it's actually important that if there's a default algorithm, that it actually changes its the exact values on every run. Otherwise, we will depend on it. And I'm not saying that you are bad. I know that I would depend on it, not deliberately, but by accident. OK. All that said, unordered map. Who's using unordered map? Everybody's using unordered map, right? Let's say, well, your internal copy of that. So unordered map is actually a good starting point. It works, it's in a standard library, but it's a little bit like driving a family car across a Formula One track if you actually know what you're doing. What I mean with knowing what you're doing is, if you know the constraints of something more complicated, you can actually deal with that. In particular, unordered map actually makes a number of stability guarantees. The first one, which is already fairly adverse, is it guarantees that your objects keep put in memory. If you put an object into an unordered set, it will stay in the same location. You can insert and erase elements, except this one element, obviously, the element gets invalidated when it gets removed, but otherwise you can rely on the same position. And there's another guarantee, and that is if you iterate over an unordered set and you basically remove or insert other elements, as long as you do not remove the element you're currently pointing on, the iterator stays valid as well. So both of these stability concerns actually have an implication on how you can implement unordered set. There are certain things you cannot do. For example, you cannot, and I think there's even there may be a small caveat with the iterator stability. It may be similar to vector that it may invalidate when it rehashes. So it's kind of only partial guarantee, possibly. But you can actually go faster. For example, you could say, or you could have different techniques by saying, for example, instead of having a list on each element, on each hash, a bucket of elements, you could choose to actually store the elements directly into the array and deal with an indication whether it's present or not, which may or may not be faster. One reason it could be faster, if you actually, instead of having a list which you travel and rather have an array where you directly store the values, is you actually have fewer memory accesses. If you need to go via a bucket to an element, you have at least an access to the array, followed by an access to the actual element, rather than directly going to the element. And so basically, roughly speaking, a typical or how unordered map kind of necessarily is implemented is you have a hash value, which gives you basically an offset into some sort of bucket array, and that bucket array goes to a list. Typically, this list is doubly linked list. It could be a singly linked list. I don't think, or I'm not actively aware of any implementation which actually uses a singly linked list. Some implementation actually use an entire list across all things. You can reasonably easy iterate over them, but that's it. Yes? Okay, you only have a forward iterator on ordered map. That may be true, but that doesn't mean that there is only a singly linked list in there, because that's an advantage of having a doubly linked list. You can it's easier to erase an individual element. You can do that with forward iterator, but actually, if you have a bucket, you would need to search the element of the iterator, because you have an iterator, and then somebody tells you remove that iterator. So you may need to you may need to actually go and find the element back to remove it. So, yes.
But it seems to me like this would be an excellent case not to waste the space throughout the entire array of elements, because you're an extra pointer, but the list is very short. The other thing is, if you're iterating over the list, the forward iterator is sufficient as long as you push a pointer.
Right.
You can push two pointers or a pointer to a pointer.
Sure.
But I'm saying that the extra cost, if you don't have the requirement in the standard to have a doubly linked list, seems like a bad choice here. Is there a reason for having it?
Well, it may be a bad choice, but I think all implementations do it. I don't know whether your implementation does it or not.
Off there the might be a reason why it has
and
to.
I don't think it has to. And I'm not entirely sure whether it's actually indeed a forward iterator, maybe a bidirectional iterator. But it is. Okay, but that's fine. So maybe it's just making it simpler and saying, right, it doesn't matter at that stage. In any case, it doesn't matter. And don't get too hung up about the doubly linked list. It's basically my point is there is a list. This is already, so basically to get to this element, you go over here and you may need to step over, over these guys to some extent. Yes. No, the size is basically the current size of the overall range of the bucket, the number of buckets. So basically, the typical way it works is initially the size would be zero. You insert one element, it becomes whatever, 16. And when it runs out of enough space, which probably doesn't happen at 16, but let's say at 13 or 12, it doubles the size. So it's basically the size is a function of how many elements do we have currently in the container and the, how's it called, the, you can even set this, this is basically a parameter, the fill rate. Say, load factor, load factor, yes. It's basically a function of the current size and the load factor. Okay, so, but roughly speaking, unordered map looks superficially, whether it's a singly linked list or not, but roughly like that. There's an interesting other idea. I posted a link to a YouTube video. This is basically at CppCon, I think 2016 or 16 or 17, where a guy from Google presented a different idea for dealing with hash collisions. Instead of having a linked list, it uses what's called open addressing. So this idea is not new, but so open addressing basically just uses the array of buckets to store the values. And if you have a collision, you basically go to the next value or you go whatever algorithm you have to find the next value. The caveat with these things is, so this is a known idea, but you kind of need for each bucket an indicator if there's an element. So you would need to find an extra bit. You could maybe do that and say, okay, we can, or we have a special value and we find a, another bit. Interestingly, you need another indicator, and that is because an element may get removed. If it got removed and it had a collision, if somebody starts searching for that, the next element would not be found if you just go, all right, there's an empty space. So it needs an also an indicator of whether the value was ever set. So it's empty or ever set. So which basically says you need some extra storage. And yeah.
Is there an alternative to just repacking it,
moving
the elements back?
Well, is there an opportunity to repacking? I don't.
Okay.
Yes, if you can follow the list, you could move it back, is the comment. That doesn't quite work because you don't know where the list actually started.
It also doesn't work.
So it might cost another. Yes, you may have basically interleaving lists of collisions. So, but bear with me. Bear with me, because I actually have a very cool idea how to deal with that differently. And you would need one bit in any case.
And one, but not two.
Sure, but even one bit you don't have.
Right.
If I want to hash into integers, I don't have an extra, like a pair of keys integer, the value is integer. I cannot promise you that any of these things is actually available. So we don't really have that. So the idea they had is, well, what if we actually have the array for our actual values plus another array where we store one byte per element? Right, then we have plenty of space to indicate whether the value was present or was absent. And, well, you could go, we could actually pack that tighter, we could just use two bits. But there's actually another idea they had, and that is, well, if you actually spend seven bits, they could actually use, in addition to the indicator, let's say the indicator whether present or not is just one bit, you have seven extra bits, and you could use seven bits of the hash key and stick them into there. So you would basically have a vector where you could match your part of your hash directly in a relatively compact way. Let me see whether I can. Maybe that works slightly better to demonstrate what I have. So we have a hash value. The hash value gives us basically an index into our array, so we expect our element here, or into a descriptor array. But the hash value, we can decide to not take some of the bits. So we have, let's say, these seven bits we do not use as an index. Maybe we use them, but this actually doesn't use them. So we use these seven bits and actually stick them into the descriptor array. Now, with that idea, we have a descriptor array where part of the hash is sitting, which is fairly compact. So the idea is to basically go check whether we find the correct seven bits in that descriptor for something which is available. And once we have found that, we look at that value, because once we have actually seen, if we have actually jumped to one of these values, it's not just we don't know yet whether it's a real value. We also need an equality comparison. But the likelihood actually should increase with these extra bits to have found the correct value. Yes? Okay, so the comment is what he said is this one key Bloom filter. Okay, I didn't recognize it, but I believe that.
But essentially, it's a Bloom filter which says it's probably in there and it's worth looking,
mm-hmm.
but it's definitely not.
Okay.
Which
yes.
What
yes.
Bloom filter does, but the Bloom filter would typically use multiple,
right.
multiple keys, and this is only using one. So it's a
right. So let me just repeat that for the benefit of people possibly watching the video. So what he said, is the key over there, and I'm probably misrepresenting what he said, but how I understand it, the key over there is basically indicating the value is guaranteed not to be there or is possibly there, which is essentially what a Bloom filter is. And so it's basically a one-level Bloom filter rather than a multi-level Bloom filter. Yes?
So from a probability standpoint, if you have, let's say, because the thing is half full. That's
mm-hmm.
Okay, so the first Bloom filter would give you a half, and the second one would give you a quarter and an eighth, and so
mm-hmm.
on. So that would be very high probability, right? Whereas this one, you're taking, let's say there's seven bits, that's 128.
Mm-hmm.
So the probability that none of the 128 are there, not so much. So it's going to give you one out of 100 times, it's going to give you, no, I don't have to bother. But 99 times, you got to go look anyway. I'm just pointing out from a probability
sure.
it's not as exciting as it sounds.
Okay, so John's comment is, I'm not going to repeat the math because I didn't entirely follow it, although I'm a mathematician, so, but probability theory I failed, so that should get me off that hook. John's comment is, it doesn't sound as exciting as it is. It's kind of, there's still a probability that we actually get collisions and we don't detect them correctly. However, this, in addition to, so whenever we have a conflict, we actually need to compare these guys for equality. So finding over here at least the guys which we already know cannot possibly conflict, and not checking them at all actually is a win. So it may be not a super exciting win, but it is probably a win.
We got it anyway, we might as well.
Right, exactly. We got it anyway, we might as well, and this is good storage, and actually you can, CPUs are good at vectorizing that stuff. You can basically go and say, yeah, look at 16 bytes at once, and it tells you which ones are possibly there.
T-bar, just one thought. Instead of using all 7 bits, what if you use only a couple of bits? That way the probability would go up. If you used only 2 bits, let's say, then you'd have a 1 out of 4 chance of it's not being...
Okay, we need to discuss that. I don't believe that. So I'm not going to repeat that. I think I want to use all 7 bits. But we can discuss that later.
Okay.
At a bar, drinking water, right? I mean, as a...
By the way, forget what I just said, it's backwards. You want to use
thank you, bits. Thank you. That's what I thought. Okay, anyway, that's not my idea. Some guys off Google came up with that, and I like US realization. It's just a Bloom filter on top in front of a hash, but still maybe a good idea. So, the other thing which I wanted to mention is the idea, people may have heard me, not a talk necessarily, but may have heard me saying that I do not believe in lock-free data structures based on having looked at queues and never understood how they work. And every time I see things, or somebody says, all right, here's a working queue, somebody else comes up and says, no, it's not. This is wrong in some way. All that said is it seems way more viable to create actually a lock-free hash. The idea of that is basically you do sort of this open addressing stuff, and you basically just do a search, and you just use the right atomic variables to figure out whether something is in there or not. The reason why I think a hash map is simpler than a queue, although it looks from a structural point of view way more complicated, is it doesn't have the ordering constraints. In a queue, you basically have the constraint that you stick something in, and you stick, or multiple elements in, and you take them out in the same order. This does not exist with a hash map. With a hash map, you basically, if you have threads accessing these things, you're only interested in what is the value at that thing, or is it present at all. All that said, there may be constraints. I don't entirely recall, there's again a pointer to the actual article which describes it. There may be constraints in saying, all right, you have only one thread which populates these things and multiple threads concurrently accessing. However, that happens to be, for example, exactly my use case. In my software, I basically have something which creates subscriptions, and this is one thread which actually just updates somewhere a map of things. And I have many threads which want to figure out very quickly, because they get blasted with lots of data from a multicast network, saying, is this thing subscribed or not? So I have, whatever, 50 threads who want to access the hash map to look, is it in there or not? And I have one thread who once in a while actually adds something or removes something to that hash. And even removal would not be a huge problem if it's not removing, but just indicating that's not there. So there's an, and basically going and I want to lock that thing, followed by looking at things up, maybe a performance problem. So it's very interesting to have a lock-free hash map. And there are actually implementation shipping, for example, with thread building blocks where you can actually take a lock-free hash map. Okay, so what else? Oh, this, yeah. This is for the standard. If people are interested, I can briefly talk about that, but it's not super interesting. Well, maybe I should talk to it anyway. There's an interesting realization with things like unordered map, especially if you have something like a string being the key. And that is, it becomes more and more popular that people actually travel in terms of string refs, or maybe they have a buffer of things. Now, if you have a string ref and you want to look something up in a hash map, you almost certainly do not stick a string ref as a key into a hash map. because you typically want to have the key being owned. This should be value type, not a reference type. But a string ref or string view is a reference type. However, you cannot normally look things up via different types. So to look things up in a hash map, you might need to create a string out of a string view, which is highly annoying. You don't really want that. We want to use a hash to make it fast, right? So there's basically an idea which actually, and the mechanics of doing that is slightly non-trivial, but it's something which actually probably should be done, is that something like you can have a string, looking things up a string view in a map. You would basically need to make sure that string view and string have compatible hashes, and basically if the character sequence they identify is the same, they should provide the same hash value. And not only that, you need to tell the generic component somehow that yes, these two types or the set of types are all of that kind. If you get one of those, you can look up without producing the key. There's basically some work actually in the standard contemplating to do that. There was a proposal to do it, but I don't think it's entirely done. I thought that was kind of an interesting aspect. I think transparent keys for maps are actually in C++ 17 or something like that. So the idea is was done for maps, but not for unordered set, because over there it's slightly more complicated. Okay. Anyway, that's pretty much what I have to talk about. So basically, I think hash maps are an important data structure for efficiency. Good hashing function needs to be done. I think the hash expansion dance is a reasonable way to actually expose hashing algorithms so that users do not have to write them. And then it may be interesting to actually come up with implementations in some sort of library of various hash maps, rather than having just the one go, here's the simple one, maybe also choices of it's lock-free or I don't care what stability things. Okay? So, anybody having any questions? Yeah.